This podcast is brought to you by the School of Advanced Study, University of London.
There is, to echo, I think, the beginning of Kathy's talk yesterday, no tango in his talk. There is no magic. There aren't even any male models, I'm afraid. And perhaps most troublingly, there is no science. So I think this talk is probably going to be at the further end, away in that kind of community of interdisciplinarity that we have. But we'll see how we get on. We're asked to say a little bit, first of all, about our kind of where we come to emotions from. So I thought I would just say a couple of minutes, really, about the work I've been doing up to this point. I suppose as a historian, my primary interest is in how so-called ordinary people, and I think there's a lot of work to be done on that category, understand, or at least how they narrate themselves in the world. Fundamentally, that's what I'm interested in. And I'm interested in that in terms of the 20th century Britain. I started out as an oral historian, so I was very interested yesterday in discussions around memory, the relationship between individual memory and popular memory, politics of memory, etc. Then I moved on to work on the history of emotion. Although for a long time I didn't see myself as being a historian of emotion, I'm still not entirely sure that I am. I like to cling to the sort of social historian identity in a kind of retro way. But I've been interested in for a long time in particular emotions and their meaning and significance. So the last book that I published was a history of love in the mid-20th century. But I've also done some work on happiness in the 1930s. Alongside that focus on specific emotions, I'm also interested more broadly in emotions as a category of historical analysis. The significance of emotion or the significance of feeling. And I've been looking at that in relation to some of the key political debates of post-war Britain. Particularly, I did some work on status of feeling within debates about capital punishment in 1940s and 1950s Britain. The two projects that I'm working on at the moment, I'm about to complete 3 years to head of department, so these are more an aspiration than a well-rounded projects. But one that I'm not going to talk about today is on feelings at work, which is looking at people's feelings about paid employment, the emotional labour and gendering of emotional labour in the workplace, the impact of work on emotional well-being and emotional management at work. But what I am going to talk about today is a separate project, which is interlinked, on emotional democracy, on political uses of feeling. And I know that Thomas has already alluded to this, but I think the last few weeks, the way in which anger has been mobilised in politics, both in the UK and in the US, the way in which claims to feel are used to support knowledge about the world, claims to knowing, is really interesting. So I'm going to be talking a little bit about that as well. So, basically in the paper I want to do two things. I want to talk a little bit about how historians get at people's understandings of their own emotions and the power of emotion or feeling. And here I'm going to talk specifically about an organisation called Mass Observation, which operated in the middle years of the 20th century. And I'm then going to, in the second part of the paper, say a little bit about, sort of give you a little case study Like Kathy, I like case studies. I think case studies are really nice. And I know it might seem a little bit madly specific for this audience, but I just want to sort of demonstrate some of the material that the archive gives us and kind of how we can use it to move beyond the individual experience to think about the collective. And crucially, I think to think about the way in which the interlinked categories of feeling and experience are used by people, are deployed as ways of knowing the world. And in the particular context I'm going to talk about, which is the context of 1945 Britain, the way in which feeling and experience is used as grounds for participating in the public sphere. And I'll explain a little bit more about that in a minute. So, in August 1945, Mass Observation, I'll say more about it in a minute, wrote to its panel. It had a panel of volunteer writers who responded to topical questions on a monthly basis. In this instance, the panelists were asked for their views on the maintenance of wartime control, because it was 1945. They were asked for their views on the treatment of Germany, and of course, on the newly elected Labour government. But they were also asked about their emotional state. Quote, describe in detail your own feelings, underlined, and views about the atom bomb and those of the people you meet. How do you feel about peace now? Those who responded were not unfamiliar with this mode of questioning. The completion of these, they were called directives, these open-ended questionnaires, was a key aspect of the volunteers' engagement with Mass Observation. For example, a couple of months earlier, in 1945, they'd been asked, how do you feel now the war is over in Europe? How does this compare with how you expected to feel? What do you think is worrying people most at present? And you get within the answers and within the questions, I think, a sense of the past, the present, and the future working together that has come up, came up certainly yesterday in some of the talks. In fact, those who wrote for the organisation were repeatedly asked for their feelings on a whole range of subjects, and the way in which the topics were framed, I think, was reversed and actively blurred. And I'm quite into blurring and messiness, which might be a problem in this context, but it blurred the distinction between what was private and what was public, what was personal and what was political, what was apparently mundane and what was subconsciously extraordinary. So the kinds of questions that were asked. In 1940, how do you feel about holidays this year? In 1942, what are your own general feelings and beliefs about venereal disease? How do you feel about the French nowadays? What do you feel about the recent bombing of Germany? And in January 1944, the Mass Observers were even asked to create a subjective mood chart, marking 10 for maximum cheerfulness and minus 10 for deepest depression. And in the years that followed the war, Mass Observation continued to compile a record of feeling. How do you feel about blindness and blind people, he asked in 1947? How do you feel about capital punishment? A questionnaire distributed in August 1950, and again this made me think about what Kathy was talking about yesterday, asked what particular bits of music, if any, give rise to strong emotions in you? And do you ever cry in the pictures? How far, if at all, do you feel ashamed on such occasions? Mass Observation's commitment to feelings-based research was more than a stylistic tick, and it extended both before and after the wartime context. Although some of the people who wrote for it did use feeling as a proxy for thought or belief. Most were clear in their reflexive answers that their responses to questions were giving an emotional dimension. Emotion was certainly both a research topic and a category of analysis for mass observation from its very beginning. In 1937, they said, observers will provide the points from which can be plotted weather maps of public feeling in a crisis. The relationship between thought, feeling, and action lay at the heart of its research practice. In 1949, one of its publications, and this I think is my favourite way that they conceptualise what they're doing, is they talked about the live dynamic of feeling and behaviour. The evidence that mass observation generated, therefore, provides us with admittedly mediated access to emotional worlds, or at least their narration. It helps us to get at what one historian has described as the messy, convoluted experience lived by thinking, feeling selves. But the words it generated also reflect wider cultural shifts, allowing us to think beyond individual experience, its narration and its interpretation, to get at what Raymond Williams described as structures of feeling. Okay, so a little bit of inexpert summary of some of the history of motion stuff. I think Thomas has given you what you need. But the point about the history of emotion really is the contention that feeling is, to a greater or lesser extent, framed by time and place. As Barbara Rosenweiss says, emotions themselves are extremely plastic. It's very hard to maintain, except at an abstract level, that emotions are everywhere the same. And an emotional turn in recent years, which, as Thomas has already indicated, isn't quite as new in its turn as is sometimes suggested, has generated diverse approaches, rooted in the various schools of historical practice within which scholars operate. So some approach emotion itself as a useful category of analysis, through which political, economic, social, and cultural histories can be reframed. And others, of course, explore individual emotions, as has already been indicated. Nonetheless, attention to emotional standards and codes still characterises the work of a lot of us, an approach for which the early work of Peter and Carol Stearns, again, Thomas has already first one of their works, provided a point of departure. And I think we do need to know a lot more about how ordinary people were instructed to feel than about the messiness of their actual or their performed emotional practice. And yet, as Sarah Armand writes, messiness is a good starting point for thinking with feeling. Feelings are messy, such that even if we regularly talk about having feelings as if they were mine, they come at us, surprise us, leaving us cautious and bewildered. Now, in what I want to do in terms of the history of emotions, I'm quite interested in the idea of the history of emotions from below. To think beyond the looking at codes and regimes, or at least to think about the intersection between lived experience and those codes. So how do we do that in terms of archives and sources? Well, of course, one way of doing that is to read official or prescriptive sources against the grain. So we might use popular advice literature, such as women's magazine pages. I love using topical pages in women's magazines as a source. to look at the dynamic between the advisor and the advisee, looking for points of contestation as well as acquiescence, acknowledging, of course, the very specific context of production of that kind of source. So, for example, I'll just give you a quick example of this. At the height of the Second World War, one woman's own reader objected to the frequent exhortations that were made to wives to forgive their erring husbands. And they published this response from one of their readers, supposed response. I want to protest to you because you say that a wife whose husband has had an affair with a girl ought to forgive him and try to understand. I don't forgive my husband, and I hate the girl even more than I hate Hitler. I consider it very wrong for you to talk like that, and I quite like the way that magazines allow, within confines, that contestation of codes, that kind of rubbing away of the edges, that idea that through a process, norms can become more practical. So, in basic terms, this is about getting at sources that allow us to look at the unexpected and subversive things, and sometimes funny things, that people do with emotional code to explore this contested space between prescription and practice. Of course, there are many other sources we can use, like history evidence, diaries, interviews, letters, photographs, the materials through which ordinary people, men, women, children as well, construct versions of their emotional selves for different audiences. And I think audience is key. It was really striking me yesterday in the discussion about memory, the need to think about the different audiences to whom we present our memories, the different ways we compose them depending on that perceived audience. And we can use these kind of sources to think about the way in which people move between what Barbara Rosenblatt again describes as specific emotional communities. Or we can think about how people deploy specific emotional styles, drawing on the work of Benno Gammel. We might also engage with recent work in cultural studies, which attends to the formation of, quote, material moods that knit together culture on the ground, to consider how individuals conceive of and are affected by distinct moodscapes as they traverse everyday life. But here I'm going to talk about film. I'm not going to show film, unfortunately. That's at the end. Middle bit is all about mass observation. Because that's really, I think, for me, where my primary research interest has been for a long time. So I just want to give you a little bit of context so you know what it is I'm really talking about. This is the Hounds of M.O., notably male, an anthropologist, Tom Harrison, a poet, journalist, and a future professor of sociology at Birmingham University, Charles Madge, and a filmmaker, Colin Jennings. Mass observation emerged out of that 1920s, 1930s documentary moment in Britain and beyond. And throughout its period, which runs really from 37 until the mid-50s, I won't get into its afterlife, it recruited both paid and unpaid observers to do work of social investigation and self-observation. And this is what they said about what they were doing. They said that their paid and unpaid observers were going to act as cameras with which we are trying to photograph contemporary life. Subjective cameras, each with his or her own individual distortion. They tell us not what society is like, but what it looks like to them. And they use a whole range of different methods. So within the archive, we can find, of course, the box. It's literally a box that has written on it, happiness. But we've also got field notes on the observation of courting couples, which I used in my last project. There are thousands of essays written by children on all manner of topics. I'm doing some work on with a colleague at Sussex, thinking about the way in which they write their own feelings about the present and also about the future. In many ways, then, to repurpose and Setkovich's phrase, mass observation operates as an archive of feelings. It also operates as an archive of feeling in another way, because the act of writing for the archive, whether as a diarist or a respondent to questionnaires, was itself a process steeped in feeling. Not least because people wrote for mass observation for a very long time. Nevertheless, wrote for over 20 years. Of course, individual motivations for participating in mass observation's work were diverse. They included a sense of citizenship, a commitment to self-improvement, the wish to be creative, a sense of the value of writing what mass observation itself describes as an anthropology of ourselves in difficult times. But emotion, a sense of emotional disturbance or emotional need, could also drive participation. A Cricklewood housewife wrote in 1937 to explain why she wanted to participate. I frequently write to release pent-up emotion of a turbulent sort. Happiness I can express through normal channels. The children cook sweets in the kitchen. I can buy a pound of fresh herrings for supper. But depression and disappointment make me mute with misery. Instead of giving the children a good whack when they annoy me, I repress my anger and remonstrate with them, and afterwards, perhaps pouring out my passions on paper. And of course, there's another dimension to the emotional nature of mass observation. And I think Thomas sort of alluded to this in terms of research processes and its impact on us as individual scholars. And of course, that's the emotional work of the researcher, the historian, coming to the archive, engaging with this particular material. But I won't say any more about that at the moment. So now, I want to just use some of the material that mass observation gathered to do a test case in how we can use individual feeling or narration of feeling to say something about a particular moment in time. And in this instance, I'm going to talk about 1945. That's dogs in wars, box of stuff about dogs in war. They're really interested in people's feelings about pets for, I don't know, important reasons. Okay, so the war. Now, of course, within 20th century British history, the impact of the war has been discussed at some length. The view that it acted as a hinge upon which the 20th century turned has recently been reasserted, sets of a major turning point, an emphasis on emergent rights and entitlements that accompanied mass mobilisation and mass sacrifice. A sense at the end of the war of a desire to make wartime experience matter. But I'm interested in the extent to which 1945 was also a moment of emotional rupture. And if it was, what the relationship between emerging structures and feelings and the politics of reconstructing Britain in the aftermath of war were. Now, this isn't to say that people haven't already looked at the emotional dimension to reconstruction. Often in the contested discussion about the status and capacity of the Labour at the government, emotion has been drawn upon. So some historians have looked at the collective apathy, resentment and disenchantment at the end of the war to make a case for actually widespread political disengagement. Whilst others have suggested that a desire to focus on the emotions of the self and the emotional well-being of the family was incompatible with an interest in the wider world, though quite frankly why that should be the case is bewildering to me. In contrast, I want to suggest that individual feeling and everyday experience were increasingly seen as legitimate grounds of participation. It's kind of taking of the self and the family outwards into the world to assert knowledge. And that this process happened well before the liberation movements, which explicitly asserted that the personal was political. Okay, so, we've got the war. The war itself, of course, had necessitated carefully calibrated emotional mobilisation. And in peace, there was a sense that the status of emotion needed to be reconfigured within an expanding public sphere. As a number of historians have demonstrated, the post-war settlement was founded upon the psychologisation of the citizenry. Attention to public emotion extended well beyond the operation of the welfare state and informed, for example, both the planning of housing and the provision of entertainment. Social psychology informed 1940s political theorising too. Both George Orwell and Evan Durbin extolled the virtues of emotional unity. The latter saw the roots of democracy as, quote, emotional rather than intellectual. So the problem of the individual in this newly reconfigured world did loom large in the writing of those mass observers who responded to directives in 1945. They wondered what the utility of individual feeling was in the face of cataclysmic world events. We might too. They wondered what was the appropriate place for emotion within the decision-making processes of a modern democratic state. Again, we might do that too. In fact, in the immediate aftermath of the conflict, a sense of emotional instability pervaded individual accounts. As one woman said, "I have noticed that many people seem more nervy, strained, and depressed now that peace is here than they did during the war. Perhaps it is a reaction, perhaps a sense of the futility of it all, perhaps the feeling which practically everyone has that the peace problem is going to be as great as the war ones. The killing stopped, but everything else would be as bad or worse, is the average opinion. One gets the feeling that people are lost and perplexed, astray in a dark forest." I just love that phrase. It's so rich to think with. Of course, the end of the war in Europe brought concrete material concerns, as might be expected. Housing and the possibility of a new war dominated the mass observers' worry lists. The mobilisation of experience and the memory of experience was nonetheless deployed as a possible solution. One retired woman felt that a constructive peace requires more unselfishness of thought and hard work than a jaded, war-weary world seems prepared to give. One would despair if there were not signs that many people are profiting by the experience of the years after the last war and are determined that things should not take the same course this time, especially with regard to unemployment. And the popular memory of that immediate period after the First World War absolutely plays out in the way people think about the future in the latter years of the Second World War. So we see the value attached to the experience of living through a different post-war. The ambiguous status of emotion within post-war Britain is clear throughout the responses. Notably so, in relation to domestic politics and world events. What was the proper place of emotion within the 1945 general election campaign, for example? Churchill's so-called Gestapo speech, in which he intimated that a socialist government would need a Gestapo-type organisation to implement its programme, was widely seen as too emotional. Quote, "It would be difficult to exaggerate the disappointment and genuine distress aroused by this speech," wrote Mass Observation at the time. Clement Attlee's subsequent broadcast was, quote, "not emotional enough for some of the workers in the weaving shed," according to a Yorkshire mill worker writing to the organisation. But on the whole, his more measured delivery, his, quote, "quiet academic voice," as one Mass Observer put it, chimed better with the mood. As Mass Observation concluded, "after 6 years of emotion, of glory, of tragedy, of heights and depths of feeling, one gets the impression that people were weary of being aroused to any kind of emotion whatever." Certainly, Mass Observation's respondents believed themselves to be well able to detect emotional fakery. And I think this question of the authenticity of emotion and feeling rests at the heart of a lot of what we think about, we talk about emotion and its power in the world. The sense that authentic emotion is quite difficult to deny. It has a power because you feel it and people can't tell you that you don't. So this sense that emotion should be authentic, there's this sort of judging of whether it is actually the authentic use of emotion in the election campaign. And yet, Churchill's emotional state also looms large in the minds of some Mass Observers following his electoral defeat. As one says, one cannot help feeling sorry for Churchill. This must have been a great shock to him, and one cannot imagine quite what he will do now. Of course, the events of early August 1945 provoked Mass Observers into particularly reflexive emotion writing. "My first response to the atomic bomb was one of complete consternation, a feeling of having lost any sense of security at all, that within a few years we would all be killed, mankind would vanish from the face of the earth," for this 28-year-old secretary. Then she continued, "at the same time I had a slight feeling of rejoicing, that this would surely bring the end of the Japanese war soon. But this was a very minor triumph compared with the staggering new effect of the news. Then gradually I began to hope that the atomic bomb would mean the end of all wars, that no nation would ever have the stupidity to risk a war that would mean complete extinction." And I quite like this very reflexive working through of emotional response, this complex fusion of feeling hope and terror simultaneously, which is very characteristic of 1940s thinking, particularly in relation to the implications of the atomic bombing of Japan. Okay, let's move towards the end then. A year earlier, in 1944, Mass Observation had asked servicemen and servicewomen to enter an essay competition entitled "My Ideas and Hopes for Post-War Conditions." A radio officer in the Merchant Navy began his contribution thus. He said, "Never before, in the midst of the jumble of heroism and horror, sacrifice and bestiality, idealism and misery that is war, have so many of the world's ordinary folk looked forward to the coming of peace with such upwelling hopes." Now, I think these hopes rested on the transformative power of emotion as much as the reforming power of politics, despite the ambiguities about the power that emotion might have. Individual emotional battles and everyday emotional exchange became powerful frames for public reconstruction narratives. We see reconstruction spinning around the personal in intriguing ways, not just in the foregrounding of the personal, the family, the home, but also in the valorization of individual feeling, wartime experience. And British films, I think, capture this spirit, this mobilisation of emotion for a collective reconstruction quite well. So, Humphrey Jennings, one of the co-founders of Mass Observation's documentary, which some of you might have seen, Diary of Timothy, 1945, tells a national story, but it weaves it around the birth of a single child. And it places personal experience and feeling at the heart of momentous world events. In fact, placing the two side by side on the screen at key moments. Feature films drew on the military experiences of writers and actors and also placed emotional healing centre stage. The Captive Heart, a 1946 Basil Dearden film, was actually co-written by a former prisoner of war, Guy Morgan. In it, the survival of a Czech prisoner of war depends on his impersonation of a dead British officer, and success hinges on the exchange of authentic love letters with a dead man's estranged wife. Notwithstanding the subterfuge, they actually fall in love for real on his release, this idea that the reward for surviving the war is love. In the Powell and Pressburger film of the same year, A Matter of Life and Death, the love of a member of the Women's Army Corps literally saves the life of David Niven's young squadron leader. Niven himself ended the war as a lieutenant colonel and took part in the Battle of Normandy. Again, memory, experience, feeling. And finally, The Way to the Stars, released in June 1945, took its title from the RAF coat of arms, drew upon Terence Rattigan's own experiences in the service, and was structured around a poem, For Johnny, written by another Royal Air Force man, John Pudney, during an actual air raid in 1941. And again, it placed emotion and a good deal of emotional reticence at its centre. Each of these representations was not just crafted out of experience, but actively collapsed the boundaries between the cultural and the social, representation and the knowable past. Knowledge of a very precise set of wartime experiences framed the emotional response of a 1940s audience to these films, although not always in ways that generated acclaim, because of course personal experience can lead people to contest the representation on the screen. Basically, my point though, is that both experience and emotion were seen to have power at this particular motion beyond the individual. And I think this is quite nicely put by woman's own agony aunt, Mary Grant, who asserted a clear link between historical moment, emotion, and good citizenship. She writes, in the last 6 years, we have seen what lack of understanding, greed, and blind selfishness can do to humanity. If we could take the machinery of war, any war, to pieces and examine it, we would probably find that a warped bitterness in one man's mind started it. Lack of understanding of ourselves and our emotional problems can have a more far-reaching effect than many of us dream. Like a stone thrown in a pond, where the serpents grow wider and wider and one is powerless to stop them. So each one of us has some kind of effect on our immediate circle, which in turn may influence a much bigger part of the community. If only we could set our problems right before the cracked circles ripple disturbingly out of reach. I believe, she concludes, that it is how people feel that ultimately decides how they live. And for her, the proper management of feeling was a fundamental way of coping with the problems of post-war British society. Indeed, in the years after 45, emotion came to matter a great deal within public as well as private life, as dominant emotional styles shifted from those rooted in self-discipline to those that celebrated self-expression. We see evidence of this in the changing self-representations of politicians and in a broader political culture that used feeling to cohere and to exclude, not least in relation to race and in relation to migration. We see too in the fields of journalism and in the growing obsession with taking the mood of the nation. It is apparent in the pervasiveness of psychological ways of thinking within the developing welfare state, as well as in the permissive legislation of the 60s, within which the right to feel and to act on one's feelings gained a measure of legal sanction. Even the economy was not immune to the advance of feeling, turned towards emotional capitalism, harnessed emotional labour, imposed emotional burdens, and claimed to valorise emotional intelligence. But I think using the evidence generated by mass observation in the middle of the 20th century, even in a sort of micro-study way, we can see messy and complex ways in which individuals understood the status and the role of emotion within a rapidly changing world, and thereby constructed themselves as emotional citizens.